sword. The widows, they made no lament. But then the Lord, full of compassion, his anger was restrained. Yet full of compassion, he remembered them again. Yet full of compassion, with a pure heart and a skillful hand. Yet full of compassion, he remembered them again. Oh, may God be gracious, gracious to us, and make his face to shine upon us. Oh Lord, may your ways be praised on the earth, so that all may come to know. May God be gracious, gracious to us, and make his face to shine upon us. On the earth, so that all may come to know. Let the people praise, let the people praise you, let the people praise, let the people praise you, let the nations come and revere him, until the ends of the earth fear him. Let the people may God be gracious, gracious to us, and make his face to shine upon us. Oh Lord God, may your ways be praised on the earth, so that all may come to know. So that all may come to know. Let the people pray. Let the people praise you, let the people praise, let the people praise you, let the nations come and revere him, till the ends of the earth fear him, let the people praise you.
Oh, let the people praise,
let the people praise you, let the people praise.
Good morning, everybody. Please come in and take a seat as we get started. Welcome to St. Barnabas Anglican Church in Fairfield this morning. My name is Wilmo, and usually I'm hiding up the back behind the computer, but today I'm up the front, so I get to see everybody's lovely face, which is really nice. If you're new or visiting, then it's really great to have you here and welcome. And if you're regularly here, then it's also really great to have you back. Today we are here to meet together as God's people to hear God's Word and learn about Jesus. Next week is a very important week. It's Easter. And although we always try to remember Jesus, the significance and good news of Jesus' death and resurrection as we meet together, we especially do so at Easter time. In the week before Easter in the church calendar, there's a day that's called Palm Sunday, and that remembers when Jesus went into Jerusalem and people were celebrating him and waving palm branches and putting down their coats on the road because they thought that he was somebody who was very special. And people were shouting praise to him, and this probably looked like the greatest day in Jesus' ministry. But today in our Bible reading, we'll learn that greatness in the kingdom of God does not look like greatness in the kingdom of this world. Jesus knew what he came to do, and it was very different to what the world thought the king would look like. It's easy for us to get the wrong idea, and maybe that's because we have wrong thinking in some ways, a wrong understanding, or maybe it's because we grow tired and distracted with something that has a hold in our life. And so today, we'll begin by resetting our eyes and our hearts on what is truly great. And we're going to sing our first song, which is How Great Thou Art. So please stand and join with us as we sing.
How great thou art, how great thou art.
Please take a seat. The Bible teaches us about God's greatness, but it also teaches us to tell the next generation of God's greatness. And it says if you train young children in the way that they should go, when they are old, they won't depart from it. So we're going to have a kids spot now, and there will be a video that will appear on the screen. So please watch the screen.
Hi kids, I'm Susan. You know, I've been doing these kids spots for quite some time now, and I think you know me pretty well. And to be honest, I think it's time for us to take our relationship to the next level. Now, I don't think you're quite ready to meet my parents yet, but there is someone whom I'd love for all of you to meet. Are you ready? Just one second.
Ta-da! Meet Cabbage, the cardigan corgi. Now, I've had Cabbage for 1.5 years, and I love her very much. She's lots of fun, she makes me laugh, and she lets me give her lots of kisses and cuddles. But you know, loving Cabbage can be really hard. There are lots of times when I'm really tired, but I still have to take Cabbage out for a walk. When she chews up my favourite things, or barks too much, too loudly, and for too long, and I want to smack her, but I hold back instead. I love Cabbage so much, I'm willing to give up many things for her.
Now in Kids Church today, you're going to meet a woman who loved Jesus very much. And this woman showed just how much she loved Jesus by pouring a whole jar of perfume on him. Now that might sound a little bit strange to you and to me, but back then, perfume was very expensive. You had to grow the flowers, you had to press it into an oil, which meant time, effort, and lots of flowers. Now, how much do you think the woman's jar of perfume cost? Hands up if you think it was 1 week's wages worth. Up, so we can see them. Now, hands up now if you think it was 1 month's worth of wages. Don't be shy. Now, if you thought it was 1 year's wages, you would be right. Now, do you think it was easy for the woman to pour all that precious perfume on Jesus? To be honest, I think it would have been really hard because it was so expensive. But the woman did it because she loved Jesus very much, and she wanted to show that by giving him the most precious thing she owned. Now, Cabbage is really hard work, and I sometimes wonder, is she worth it? But Jesus is absolutely worth it. You see, when Jesus met that woman, he was on his way to Jerusalem to die on a cross. And when the woman poured that perfume on Jesus, she was preparing Jesus to save us from our sins. Now, when all the people saw the woman pour the precious perfume on Jesus, they were so angry because she was wasting all of that perfume. And one of the people there actually betrayed Jesus for much less. But the woman in our story shows us that Jesus is worth giving up everything for. But what about you? What precious things are you willing to give up to follow King Jesus? Now I want you to take a moment, close your eyes with me, and picture the most precious thing you own. What's the most precious thing you own? Now would you be willing to give that up to follow Jesus? Now we're going to head into kids' church in a little bit, and I want you to share your thoughts with the other kids and with your leaders. Now, it's a hard question, but I want you to be honest. See you next time. Bye.
Thanks, Susan. I'm going to pray for the kids and the kids' leaders as they head next door, and then we'll continue to meet to learn about Jesus as kids and as adults as well. So Please join with me as I pray. Thank you, Father, for giving us Jesus. Thank you for revealing us to him as your son and as our Savior, and for how precious he is. And we pray today as we learn more about Jesus that you would help us to see how precious he truly is. And we pray for the kids who are giving up their Sunday mornings to learn about Jesus, and for the leaders who are giving up their Sunday mornings to teach about Jesus. We pray that you would be with them at this time, and also with us as we hear more about Jesus, so that we can be people who are willing to give up everything that we can to show the immeasurable worth of who Jesus is. And we pray all of this in his name. Amen. So if you're in primary school, you can go across with your leaders into the big hall. And if you're below primary school age, then go with the creche leaders who are in the orange vests into the small hall. And parents, could you please take your kids and sign them in? Everyone else will have a 5-minute break and get to catch up with each other. So thank you.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O Lord my God, you are clothed with splendor and majesty, covering yourself with light. He stretched out the heavens like a tent, lays the beams of his chambers on the waters, and then makes the clouds his chariot and rides on the wings of. Set the earth on its foundations, the waters they stood above the mountains, but at your rebuke, at the sound of your thunder, the mountains they rose and the valleys sank under to the very place that you appointed for them. So they may never cover the earth again. Oh, Lord, help me. Oh, sing to the Lord. All the earth sing a new song. Bless his name. Salvation from day to day. Sing to the Lord. All the earth sing a new song. Bless his name and tell of his salvation from day to day. And declare his glory. For the Lord, he is worthy. Sing to the Lord. All the earth sing a new song. Bless his name. His salvation from day to day to day. Sing to the Lord. All the earth sing a new song. Bless his name and tell of his salvation from day to day and declare his glory. Great is the Lord, he is worthy. For the gods of the people are worthless. But the Lord, he made the heavens. ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. All that's due his name, bring an offering and come into his courts, worship the Lord in splendor. The man trembled before him, all the earth say, among the nations the Lord he reigns. 'Cause he established the world and it will never be shaken. And let the heavens and the earth be glad, for the Lord he come. Let the sea roar, let the trees sing, for the Lord he come. He will judge the world in righteousness, for the Lord he come. And the nations with his faithfulness, for the Lord he come. Let the heavens and the earth be glad, for the Lord he come. Let the sea be roar, let the trees sing, for the Lord he come. He will judge the world in righteousness, for the Lord he come. And the nations with his faithfulness, for the Lord he come.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to church today. My name's Gus. I'm one of the ministers here. I'll be back up a bit later helping us listen to God's word as we have a Bible talk. But right now, I just want to say welcome. Welcome to church. We're really glad you're joining us, whether you've been here every week or if this is your first time or you're back after not being here for a while. I want to let you know about some things coming up at church, and something coming up today that I want to invite anyone who's newish to is called Newish. It's our Newish lunch, and it is anyone who's joined us recently and never been to a Newish lunch with us. It's over at my house right next door, and it's an opportunity to have lunch with us with a few people from church, and I'll share a little bit about what church is, what we're on about as a church, and how you can be involved with us here. So please do come. There's lots of food, and you're more than welcome. If you do want to come, come speak to me, or speak to Sarah, my wife, over there, and we'd love to have you at Newish lunch this afternoon. A few other things coming up. On Thursday, we have our Easter Thursday dinner, a bit of a tradition here at church. Jesus shared the Lord's Supper with his disciples the night before he was killed, and we share the Lord's Supper on the Thursday night, kind of remembering what he did. And we also have a meal together. That's out, hopefully, weather permitting, out in the back garden of church, around the playground there. We'll have lots of food. We're asking if you're able to bring some food to share. And if you're not able to, there'll be some extra food anyway. And you can chip in to help with that extra food if you're able to as well. Then it's Easter. Good Friday, we'll have church here at 10:30. It'll be combined with evening church, lots of people here. And we'll still have Kids Church and Creche as well. I do want to encourage you, please do be inviting people to that. There's some flyers out the back if you want to hand them out. Letterbox the area around us if you want to. Then Easter Sunday, 10:30 church will be on as usual as well. And then we're just letting you know about something coming up in a month and a half is our big day out. It's for all six of our congregations. We'll be together for Saturday morning and into lunch. We'll be going to Hoxton Park Anglican Church, which is a bigger building. We'll fit us all. There'll be a kids program in the morning. We'll be joining with all our other congregations and thinking about what we're on about as a church and what we can be doing to reach Fairfield and Bosley Park areas in the year ahead. So please do join us for Big Day Out. You can register. I'll put the link up on our WhatsApp group. If you're not part of our WhatsApp group, and you sometimes we just put out little announcements, links to register for things, people might put on there if they're going out to the park and want people to join them. Let me know if you want to be part of the WhatsApp group. I can add you to that easily. Now, just a reminder, there's some giving boxes at the doors, details on how to give electronically or in the information sheets if you're able to support the ministry that way as well. We're going to spend some time praying, and so Sarah is going to come up and lead us in our weekly prayer points.
Morning, everyone. You might remember a while ago we used to pray for Kate and BJ. Kate, a long time ago, was on staff team here in Fairfield and Bossley Park. Then she went to Nepal with CMS and she met BJ there and they got married and we supported them in Nepal. Then they came back to Australia so BJ could do some theological study himself. And we wrapped up supporting them towards the end of last year. But we're going to be starting praying for them again because this year they're looking to start a Nepali church ministry of some form in Hurstville or around that area. There are loads and loads. Apparently the Nepalis have overtaken other nationalities as the most common nationality in Hurstville now. So 70,000 Nepalis live in that area of Sydney, and Kate and BJ have a real heart for the Nepali people and are trying to start some form of ministry to share Christ with them. So we're going to be praying for them regularly. We're also praying for ourselves to have boldness and confidence talking to people about Jesus this week with Easter and the New South Wales government. So please join me as we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Kate and BJ and their heart for you. We pray that you would help them to seek your guidance as they look to start a ministry amongst Nepali people in Sydney this year. Please provide everything that they need, and we pray that you would grow your church among the Nepali people in Sydney, bringing more to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray for opportunities for BJ to train up other local Nepali church leaders across Sydney. And we also pray for their daughter Apu as she begins university study this year, that you would help her to connect with other Christians on campus and that her health would continue to be well enough for her to study. We give you thanks and praise that the Lord Jesus willingly went to the cross to die for us so that through repentance and trust we are able to call you our Father and have the hope of eternal life with you. We give thanks that we're able to celebrate that great truth over this coming week and next long weekend at Easter. Please give us opportunities to share about Jesus with our friends and family. Give us confidence and boldness as we do that, knowing that you have the power to bring people from death to life as they hear the gospel. We ask that you'd use our church gatherings over the Easter weekend and other ministries happening this week, like Playtime tomorrow, to share the good news of Jesus with our local community. Finally, Lord, we give you thanks that you are all-powerful and in control of all things, including placing leaders and rulers and authorities over us. We pray that more people, particularly our leaders, would recognize the Lord Jesus and put their trust in him. Today, we pray for our Premier, Chris Minns, and his cabinet, along with our local members, David Saliba and Hugh McDermott. We ask that everyone in the New South Wales government would lead humbly with wisdom and compassion for all those in our state, particularly as they make decisions about health, education, transport, and the ongoing issues with the rising cost of living. We give you thanks and pray for Christians who work in the New South Wales government. And we ask all these things in the powerful and mighty name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
We're going to be continuing to sing together now, and this is going to be a new song. It's an Easter song because one of the greetings that people traditionally do on Easter Sunday is to say, Christ is risen, and then the response is, He is risen indeed, because it's a reminder of the truth, of the good news that Jesus did not stay in the grave, but He was raised to life for our justification. And we're going to sing this new song together, so the band will lead it, and feel free to join in as soon as you get along with it. So please stand and join with us as we sing.
I'll sing on myself. Yeah. has borne our sin through sacrifice to conquer every sting of death. Sing, sing hallelujah. For joy awakes as dawning light when Christ's disciples lift their eyes. Alive he stands, their friend and king. Christ, Christ, he is risen.
Christ is risen.
Where doubt and darkness once had been, they saw him and their hearts believed. But blessed are those who have not seen, yet sing hallelujah. Once bound by fear, now bold in faith, they preach the truth and power of grace, and now works in us to powerfully save. He frees our hearts to live his grace. Go tell of his goodness.
Christ is risen, he's risen indeed.
Oh, sing hallelujah. Join the chorus, sing with the redeemed. Christ is risen, he's risen.
Because, like we traditionally would continue, we have a traditional greeting of he is risen indeed. We also have some other things that we traditionally say in church. And so we're going to do a statement of faith now, or a creed, which just means saying what you believe. And so please join with us as we read the words that are on the screen. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, universal, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please take a seat. If you want to know what Christians believe, that's a good summary of what it is that Christians believe. But we also saw that Jesus was written about in the prophets and in the scriptures. And so we're going to have a time of reading the Bible now. And I'll just read a little bit that is going to get us up to date on our first reading before Scott comes up to do our first reading and Mercy comes up to do our second reading. So, last week we were introduced to Israel's most infamous king, Ahab. Apart from rejecting God, Ahab also married Jezebel, who introduced the wicked practice of Baal or other god worship in the land. In response, God raised up one of the great prophets of the Old Testament, Elijah. And Elijah pronounced a drought upon the land, and after 3 years of drought, God sends Elijah to meet Ahab again for this climactic showdown. So Scott will do our first Bible reading, and then Gus will come up after that.
Morning, church. So again, our first Bible reading comes from 1 Kings, chapter 18, starting at verse 16. And I'll just give everyone just a moment so we can all get there to read together. So once again, it's 1 Kings, chapter 18, starting at verse 16 and proceeding to verse 30. So Obadiah went to meet Ahab and told him, and Ahab went to meet Elijah. When he saw Elijah, he said to him, "Is that you, you troubler of Israel?" "I have not made trouble for Israel," Elijah replied, "but you and your father's family have. You have abandoned the Lord's command and have followed the Baals. Now summon the people from all over Israel to meet me on the Mount of Carmel, and bring the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah who eat at Jezebel's table." So Ahab sent word throughout all Israel and assembled the prophets on Mount Carmel. Elijah went before the people and said, "How long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him." But the people said nothing. Then Elijah said to them, "I am the only one of the Lord's prophets left, but Baal has 450 prophets. Get two bulls for us. Let Baal's prophets choose one for themselves, and let them cut it into pieces and place it on the wood, but not set fire to it. I will prepare the other bull and put it on the wood, but not set fire to it. Then you call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord. The God who answers by fire, he is God." Then all the people will say, "What you say is good." Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, "Choose one of the bulls and prepare it first. Since there are so many of you, call out the name of your God, but do not light the fire." So they took the bull given to them and prepared it. Then they called on the name of Baal from morning till noon. "Baal, answer us," they shouted. But there was no response. No one answered. They danced around the altar they had made. At noon, Elijah began to taunt them. "Shout louder," he said. "Surely he is a god. Perhaps he is deep in thought, or busy, or traveling. Maybe he's sleeping and must be awakened." So they shouted louder and slashed themselves with swords and spears, as was their custom, until their blood flowed. Midday passed, and they continued their frantic prophesying until the time of the evening sacrifice. But there was no response. No one answered. No one paid attention.
Morning, church. The second Bible reading is taken from the book of Mark, and we're reading today from chapter 9, starting at verse 30 to 50. That's found on page 821 of the church Bibles. Mark chapter 9, starting from verse 30. They left that place and passed through Galilee. Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were, because he was teaching his disciples. He said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise." But they did not understand what he meant and were afraid to ask him about it. They came to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the road?" But they kept quiet because on the way they had argued about who was the greatest. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, "Anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and the servant of all." He took a little child whom he placed among them. Taking the child in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me does not welcome me, but the one who sent me." "Teacher," said John, "we saw someone driving out demons in your name, and we told him to stop because he was not one of us." "Do not stop him," Jesus said, "for no one who does a miracle in my name can in the next moment say anything bad about me, for whoever is not against us is for us. Truly I tell you, anyone who gives you a cup of water in my name because you belong to the Messiah will certainly not lose their reward. If anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe in me, to stumble, it would be better for them if a large millstone were hung around their neck and they were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than with two hands to go into hell, where the fire never goes out. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life crippled than to have 2 feet and be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, pluck it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and be thrown into hell, where the worm that eats them do not die and the fire is not quenched. Everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can you make it salty again? Have salt among yourselves and be at peace with each other."
Well, good morning again, everyone. We have our two Bible readings. The first one, we're in the middle of this sort of exciting story from the Old Testament where it's kind of God versus the pagan gods, the true God versus the false gods, and we're finding out who's going to win, and you'll have to come back next week to find out that God wins. We've also got our second Bible reading. That's what our sermon is on. Mark chapter 9 is what we're up to as we're going through Mark's gospel. I'm going to help us think about what we heard from Mark just then. Let me pray for us as we start. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you are the true God, that you win all battles, that Jesus has come and died and risen for us to save us, and we get to remember that at Easter. And we pray now as we're in reading Mark 9 this morning, you would help us again understand Jesus and his greatness and help us be people who serve him. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to start by getting you to imagine a scenario. It is made up. I want to be clear about that. And I just want you to think about why I'm sort of raising this as a scenario. How does it help us understand today's passage, okay? I want you to imagine that this afternoon I get home and Sarah, my wife, says that we need to chat. She explains that she's just been to the doctor and the doctor's done some tests. And the doctor has said that Sarah has cancer. And the doctor has said that she's going to die and she's just got a week left. What do I say? What if I said this? Guess what? I just preached the best sermon ever today. It was fully 1 hour, but everyone said it felt like 5 minutes. It was so good that I should just preach that same sermon every week after this, because there'll never be a better sermon. Vino said his was better. But it wasn't. Stephen said his was better, but mine's already got 1 million YouTube views. I mean, do you see the problem? It's kind of awkward, someone talking like that. Especially a minister bragging. But it's also got a complete lack of empathy. If my wife was dying, which she's not, but if she was, and I completely ignored her, and I was only concerned about myself, what would you say about that? You'd say it's horrible. You see, this kind of helps us think about what the disciples were doing when they talked to Jesus? Let me read from verse 30. I'll put the verses on the screen. Helpful. If you've got a Bible, you could read it there as well. It says, "They left that place and passed through Galilee. Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were because he was teaching his disciples." Big crowds have been following Jesus around, but now he wants to take his disciples aside because he wants to teach them. It's kind of saying that this is important. This is important teaching to listen to carefully. And so what does he teach them? Well, verse 31, he continues. He said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise." But they did not understand what is meant, and they were afraid to ask him about it. This is the second time that Jesus has said to his disciples that he's going to be killed and 3 days later rise again. But again, the disciples don't understand it. And if you've been here over the last few weeks, you'll see that's a pattern that's been happening. They don't get it. Maybe it's just too much outside what they can imagine, what they're expecting. And so this time they don't get it, and so they continue walking down the road. And what happens next? Verse 33, it says, "They came to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them, 'What were you arguing about on the road?' But they kept quiet, because on the way they had argued about who was the greatest." And can you imagine them walking along? It's like John looks at Peter and he says, "I'm the best disciple. Jesus is always taking me with him." But then Peter hears that and he says, no way, I'm the best disciple. Jesus is always staying in my family's house," because he was. Can you see why I got you to imagine what I got you to imagine at the beginning? Because that's here, what the disciples have done. And it makes no sense, does it, for them to be arguing about who's the best while they're walking along with Jesus? I mean, first of all, who is Jesus? Only a few weeks ago, we heard Peter say that Jesus is the Messiah. That means he's God's chosen king, coming to rule God's people with all of God's power and authority. I mean, Jesus is the greatest. These guys are sitting here arguing about which of them is the greatest. And then even more kind of confronting, Jesus has just said he's going to be killed. And surely they'd be at least a little bit concerned about that. But instead, they're arguing like a bunch of school kids. It's like they've just forgotten what he said, or they don't care. Or they're so self-absorbed that they don't give it any thought. Or they don't understand what he means. But do you feel the frustration with them? Their pride in that moment as they talk about how good they are, it seems so out of place, doesn't it? But as we watch these disciples, there's something else that should make us think about. We all do the same thing. I'm sure every one of us has had moments of pride, where each of us has felt like we deserve more than other people, where each of us have felt upset when people haven't recognized us in the way that we feel we should be recognized and appreciated. Think back some times in my life. When I was in my late teens, I was teaching Sunday school at my old church, and I remember doing that for a number of years, and then one year, all my friends got asked to lead youth group, and I was left leading Sunday school. I remember being disappointed. Why did they get to do what I thought was the more exciting ministry without me? I think a lot of it was my pride. I wanted to be asked to do what I thought was more fun and more exciting. When I was asked to lead youth group the next year, but even then, we only had a small youth group. There were a couple of churches near us that had really big youth groups. Everyone wanted to go to those youth groups. When we ran an event, they were small events. When those other big youth groups ran events, they got big bands to come and play, kind of thing. Our events seemed lame in comparison. And then when I got to give a talk at youth group, I wanted everyone to say, Hey, that was a really good talk. I kind of knew it wasn't when I gave my first talk. I'm sure we have all wanted people to recognize us. We've all wanted to be part of something big and great because it makes us feel important and that we've succeeded. And I'm sure we've all been disappointed at times when we've been overlooked. But if think about Jesus' disciples and their pride at arguing about who was the greatest, if that seemed out of place after Jesus said he was going to die, how much worse is our pride? When we understand what Jesus did, we can look back. Jesus hadn't died yet. He was on his way to die with the disciples. I can understand why they didn't understand it. But we can look back. We can see all of Jesus' teaching on this. We can see he died and rose as king and he reigns as king. You see what I mean? The disciples' response to being Jesus being killed seemed out of place. But our response to knowing that Jesus died for us is just as out of place if we are proud in what we do. Well, Jesus knows what his disciples are thinking, and he wants to help them understand. And so he says some things to help show what real greatness looks like. And that's the second point in your outline. The rest of chapter 9 is a series of little teachings from Jesus. Jesus says lots of little short statements in the rest of this chapter, and some of them are a bit hard to understand. You could think of them like little parables. Sometimes Jesus' parables are a little bit hard to understand. But if you know Jesus and if you listen to Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then they make sense. And so I'm going to go through each of these little teachings, and I want you to think about each one. And which one do you find the most challenging? Which one confronts you the most, okay? So the first thing Jesus says is here in verse 35. They're sitting down. Jesus called the 12 and said, "Anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and the servant of all." In one sense, saying that to be first, you must be a servant of everyone, it makes no sense. We know in our experience of life that the first are first and the last are last. You know, winners get gold medals, losers get nothing. CEOs get to fly in private jets and cleaners catch the train home. And that's what we see around us all the time. But as Christians, we know that Jesus turns that upside down. He is the Son of God. But he gave up his position in heaven to become a man, to die on a cross, to give his life to serve us. I mean, people still do have respect for people who give up their lives to serve others. This week we're listening to a podcast on the Titanic as we were driving somewhere. I'm sure many of you have seen the movie. One of the things everyone remembers about the Titanic is that the men let the women and children get on the lifeboats first. Many men died and they gave their lives to serve others. And that was kind of really respected about the whole tragedy. There's no greater act of service than to give your life for someone. But at the same time, while people remember that, also the rich people got the nice cabins. The first got to go in first class. But not with Jesus. He was the greatest. He is the greatest. And so he deserved to be in first class in the best suite. But instead he made himself the most humble servant to save people and to bring them into his kingdom. And so he's telling us to act like him, to do the same. It'd be a bit odd, really, for us to meet Jesus in heaven and have to explain to him all the time we didn't serve others. You get what I mean? He served us so much, and when we turn up and meet him, we've got to explain why we didn't serve others. So Jesus' first point is to be like him. Don't try and put ourselves above others, but serve others. That's the first thing Jesus said. The second little teaching is related to that. In verses 36 to 37, Jesus gives a simple example of how to serve people. So here's verse 36. He took a little child who he placed among them. Taking the child in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me does not welcome me, but the one who sent me." Jesus is saying that when we honour the smallest and lowest people in society, we are honouring God. It's interesting. The first time Sarah and I ever came to Fairfield was for a wedding. It was about a year before we first came to St. Barnabas, and the wedding was at Paradiso in the middle of Fairfield. And there were lots of important people there. The state politician was there. And the father of the bride had invited all his other important business associates. And so every speech started by acknowledging all these important people. And everyone said thank you to Guy Zangari for coming to the wedding. He was the politician. But no one acknowledged the children who were there. No one even thought they were important enough to get a mention. But here with Jesus, the children represent the unimportant people who normally get overlooked. Right through Mark, we've seen that Jesus has welcomed poor people and sick people. He's always welcomed people who wouldn't get a mention in wedding speeches. Jesus welcomes everyone into his kingdom. Is it just for us to think about, who do we welcome to church? There are people who are harder to welcome. When someone comes in who doesn't understand social cues, do we persevere in talking to them? When someone needs a lift to get home or to dinner, are we happy to give that lift every week? At the beginning of the year, when you've seen who's in your growth group, when growth groups are assigned, have you ever sort of been relieved to see his friends in the growth group? What about if harder people are in the group? They are the people we might feel are less important. They are the people we might feel are harder to serve. That's the point. Some people might seem insignificant in worldly terms, but Jesus thought they were valuable enough for him to give his life for them. And just for us, next time we're finding it hard to talk to someone or include someone, remember Jesus was willing to serve them on the cross. He wants us to serve them as well. That's the second little teaching. Third little teaching, it's in response to something the disciples now say in verse 38. This time it's the disciples talking again, and again they're showing that they don't understand what Jesus is saying. Verse 38, "Teacher," said John, "we saw someone driving out demons in your name, and we told him to stop because he was not one of us." Now the disciples, they see someone else, someone who's not one of the 12 disciples casting out demons, and they think, hey, that's our job. We're Jesus' special disciples. No, hey, you can't do that. I think the disciples are really just jealous. Do you remember what happened at the beginning of last week's passage? There was a boy with an evil spirit, and his dad took the boy to the disciples, but the disciples couldn't kick out the spirit, that evil spirit. And now they see someone else doing what they couldn't do. And so they're jealous, and they told them to stop. I'm sure we can be jealous too. I mean, we can even get jealous about ministry things. I'm sure I was a little bit jealous when my friends got to do what I thought was that more exciting youth ministry, or when I saw the bigger youth group around us. I mean, do we get jealous about bigger churches or nicer churches or richer churches in richer areas? Or do we get jealous when people get to serve in more exciting ministries? One of those, check our hearts. Sometimes our jealousy can come out in the way we talk about people. I'm thankful I don't actually hear this much in our church, but Christians have spent a lot of time fighting each other and criticizing different churches and the way they do things. But here's what Jesus says in reply to his disciples. He said, "Do not stop him," Jesus said, "for no one who does a miracle in my name can in the next moment say anything bad about me. For whoever is not against us is for us. Jesus is saying, don't get jealous of other Christians. We're all on the same team. Now, we do need to be thoughtful about who is on the same team and who is not. In that sentence, Jesus does say that no one can be serving him and say bad things about him. People who serve Jesus will honour Jesus in what they say. They'll say the truth about Jesus. Sometimes it is important to point out when another church is not honouring Jesus, or when they're caught in great sin and they don't honour Jesus as the divine Son of God. But we need to also make sure we remember we're on the same team. And if the church is bigger than ours, what should we do? Let's praise God and be thankful. Jesus wants us to be thankful that they're with Jesus. Let's go on to the fourth little teaching, verse 41. He says, truly I tell you, anyone who gives you a cup of water in my name because you belong to the Messiah will certainly not lose their reward. I mean, giving someone a cup of water seems pretty insignificant. Now, if you've ever been to like a resort in Asia, as you arrive at the resort, there's often sort of waiters there holding drinks for you as you get in because it's all hot and muggy. Of course, they're probably the least paid workers at the resort, the most basic job there. But Jesus is saying even the smallest acts of service done for Jesus are so valuable for God, to God. He will reward even the smallest things done in Jesus' name. I think that's what I needed to remember when I was left teaching Sunday school. God thought that ministry was so important. I'm convinced that what our kids, church leaders and creche leaders doing now, teaching our kids, is so important. Are there ministries and ways of serving in church that we feel are more important than others? And we need to remember what Jesus says. Everything done in the service of God and for his people is fully valuable and important to God. And so it's tempting to think that greatness comes from how important we are, or how important what we do is. And so Jesus shows us what true greatness looks like. It comes from serving God, humbly serving God. That's what Jesus did. That's what he expects us to do. And it's actually a really freeing thing. If our value is just based on how important we are and the important things we do, then we'll never be content. We'll always want more. There'll always be someone more important than us. We'll be jealous of them. There'll always be reason to be jealous of other people. But if we know that Jesus has served us, and if we live like him, then that is real peace and contentment. And Jesus also warns us that there is a cost for putting our greatness first. Now, if we stay on that path of pride and jealousy, there is a cost. And so up to his fifth little teaching. Here he shows that our pride and ambition can hurt other people. Here's what he says in verse 42. He says, if anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe in me, to stumble, it will be better for them to have a large millstone hung around their neck and they were thrown into the sea. And Jesus again talks about little children. I remember the children represent the weak and vulnerable that he came to save. He's talking about Christians. He's warning us not to do anything that would cause Christians to stumble. It'd be better to suffer a horrible death now than to face God's judgment for doing that. The thing that would cause people to stumble are the things he's already talked about. If we act like we're better than other Christians, we're implying that they're less valuable to God. And of course, that's not true. But if they start to believe us, if someone sees you so confident that you're better and they really feel that they're less important to God, then they might feel that God doesn't love them. And then they'll feel maybe that God doesn't love them enough to save them, that they're not good enough for Jesus to save. And then it might affect their faith in Jesus. We don't want that to happen. But I promise you, It does happen. I promise you that there are people who have felt they're not good enough Christians and has made them question their faith. So let's be careful how we talk about ourselves and other people. Don't let our pride and ambition hurt other people. But Jesus also warns us that our pride and ambition can also hurt ourselves. Here's verses 43 to 48. He says, six little teaching. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than with two hands and go into hell, where the fire never goes out. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life crippled than to have two feet and be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, pluck it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hell, where the worms that eat them do not die and the fire is not quenched. I think what he's talking about, he's saying that our hands and eyes and feet are the things we use to get ahead. We want to take things with our hands. We see things we want. We run after the things we want. And he's saying, cut off anything that causes you to chase after selfish ambition and pride. Because where does that lead to? If you serve yourself instead of Jesus, you'll end up far from Jesus. He says you'll end up in hell. And Jesus promises us that that is the worst unending nightmare. It is hard to give up pride. It's painful. But the pain of not giving up our pride is far worse. I think that's what Jesus is saying in the next verses too. Verse 48 is a little cryptic. But this is what he says, seventh teaching. He says, everyone will be salted with fire. Now, what does that mean? Well, salt is a seasoning. Some of you will know Salt Bay. You know, MasterChef, they're always saying a dish needs extra seasoning. You know, add a little more salt, make it taste a little bit better. Salt also preserves things before fridges. People salted meat to make it last so that it stayed good. Jesus is saying that fire will make us last and stay good. So a side note, Leviticus 2 in the Old Testament is helpful for understanding this because in the Old Testament, it talks about how they had to make sacrifices and they'd be burnt on the altar, and they were told to add salt to their sacrifices before they were burnt. So there you got sacrifices being burned with salt in it. I think what Jesus is saying, following Jesus requires sacrifice. We don't burn them on an altar anymore because Jesus has died as our final sacrifice. But the fire might be the pain of giving up our pride and ambition, the cost of serving, the cost of doing what Jesus has asked us to do, but it will help us persevere and last to the end as the people Jesus wants us to be. Then we come to verse 50. It also talks about salt again. It says, salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? That sounds odd. If you know anything about salt, sodium chloride, it can't actually lose its saltiness. It stays as salt. But I'm told back then, their salt wasn't as pure as ours. It had lots of other stuff in it. And then the salt, through water coming into it, could leach out through the pottery, and you'd end up with the salt would kind of have more of those contaminants in it. And so it tastes funny. If that's what he's thinking about, I don't know. Either way, what he's saying is, it is good to be... He's saying, what good is it to be a follower of Jesus if you don't follow Jesus? You know, salt should be salty. Followers of Jesus should be followers of Jesus. What good is it to let pride and ambition replace serving and sacrifice? If it leads you away from Jesus, there's no way back. And so he says, right at the end, have salt among yourselves and be at peace with each other. So Jesus, he is concerned about relationships. Really, that's what pride and ambition gets away in, isn't it? It gets in the way of relationships. If I want to be the greatest, it means I want other people to be put down below me. But Jesus says, be at peace with each other. A salty life is a life that humbly serves people, like Jesus served us. And so to wrap up, I want to think about, what does true greatness look like? These disciples, remember, they were arguing about who was the greatest. Jesus had just said he was going to die and rise for them. They didn't understand. But we've seen Jesus shows us what true greatness looks like. And he shows us that the Christian life is not about our greatness, it is about Jesus' greatness. In his kingdom, true greatness comes through service. But to finish, I do want to go back to that, what I said at the beginning of the sermon. I got you to imagine a silly story about me. This time, I want you to imagine how the disciples could have responded differently to Jesus. Jesus said he's going to die and rise, but the disciples were too scared to ask what that meant because they didn't understand. Imagine if the disciples had instead put up their hand and asked Jesus, hey, Jesus, what do you mean you're going to die? You know, you're the Messiah. Well, it's Palm Sunday. We're remembering Jesus. It's the day Jesus walked into Jerusalem. They expected him to be king on a throne in the middle of Jerusalem. Dying doesn't sound part of that plan, Jesus. How would Jesus have replied? He might have said, I'm dying for you. All of your sin means you can't be with the Father in heaven. I'm going to fix that problem. I'm going to give my life as the perfect sacrifice for your sin. And then I'm going to rise back to life to show that death is defeated. And then I'm going to head back to heaven to wait for you. I can't wait to show you how good it is. And then the disciples might have said, hey, Jesus, you're the greatest. I think they might have also thought, I kind of, you know, you can wonder, hey, Jesus, why can't we go there now? Why do we have to wait here? Maybe Jesus might have said, because I need you to tell people about me. I want you to show people what it looks like to follow me. Show them what it means to serve people. Show them what real greatness looks like. So they'll understand what I have done for you. And the disciples might have gone away and talked more about how they could be more like Jesus. Eventually they did, of course. After Jesus died and rose, when he gave them his spirit, they gave their lives to serving Jesus and his church. And I'm going to pray for us. I'm going to pray for us now that as we look back at what Jesus did for us, that we would also imitate him. Let's pray. Father God, thank you that Jesus came to serve us. We don't deserve it. And so, Father, help us see how incredible and life-changing Jesus' sacrifice is for us. Lord God, we pray you'd help us listen to Jesus' teachings. We're feeling proud and jealous, Father. Help us see how crazy that is to live that way when we know that Jesus died on the cross for us. Father, also, if we're feeling small and less useful, Father, help us see how much you value even the most humble service. Father, we pray you'd help us imitate Jesus and show how great he is. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Gus. I'm not sure how you're feeling after that, whether there's been a reminder that you are not that great, or maybe you needed to be reminded that you think too highly of yourself. And there are many different things that we might have gotten out of this, but what we need to remember is that we're all servants of the Lord Jesus if we put our trust in him. And so we are working for the cause of Christ, our King, and we're going to sing our final song now, which is a reminder of that, the greatest thing that we could ever be working for. So please stand and join with us as we sing. Take a seat. In Mark 9:30-32, it says, "They left that place and passed through Galilee. Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were because he was teaching his disciples. He said to them, 'The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise.' But they did not understand what he meant, and they were afraid to ask him about it." This week, maybe you're here and you don't understand what is meant by Jesus' death and resurrection. Well, there are plenty of opportunities this week as we look up to Easter to hear about what that means and to gather together as God's people. Or maybe you've been following Jesus for a while and and we still don't quite understand what Jesus meant and what true greatness looks like in the kingdom of God. Again, there is plenty of opportunities to hear from God's word and to meet together to understand what true greatness looks like. But we've seen today that true greatness is found only in Jesus and what he reveals of God. And so I'm going to pray for us this week as we go out that we will be able to look to him and understand just how truly great that he is and how much he is worth giving up everything in our lives for him. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for the reminder of who Jesus is, that he is your Son, our Savior, and our Lord. Please help us this week to live a life that recognizes who Jesus truly is, to be changed and shaped by who he is. And we thank you for the opportunities that we have at Easter time to hear about who Jesus is and also to share it with others about who Jesus is. And we pray that you would help us to live a life shows worship and glorifies Jesus, and that many will come to see and to trust in him this week and in the weeks to come. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please join us next door for morning tea if you can. And if you're newish, then we would love you to stay around for lunch next door at Gus and Sarah's house as well to get to know a bit more about church and people here. So thank you for coming and have a great week and a great Easter.